Oh, I'm so thankful to be here. This is exactly where I want to be. I would want to be nowhere else than right here with you, our precious family. And none of you are here by accident. None of us. None of us in this whole room. Because the Lord wants to do something extraordinary and amazing for us, like a present. How many love getting good presents? I think today is going to be a present. It's already been a present for me, because Pastor Ben said one thing that literally was exactly what I needed. You know when you're really thirsty and you need a drink? And all he had to say, this is straight from the Holy Spirit, you said there's plenty of people to say what's wrong with you, but, sorry, I'm going to get a little crying.
Wow, already.
Thank you. Oh, I have to finish the sentence. Yeah. But we're here to tell you what's, God wants to tell you what's right with you.
Yes, I heard that as well. That was very, very powerful. Well, good morning, church. Turn to your neighbor and say, you're looking better than ever. Come on. You're looking better than ever. All right, now what I want you to do is I want you to tell them one thing that was good over this last week. Okay, tell them one thing that was good in your life over this last week. Do it. Come on.
Thank you, Lena. You're such a good sister. And so did you, girlfriend.
Good.
Thank you, sweetie.
Oh, give thanks. You know, I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. This has been, from what I hear, a fabulous weekend for the women.
Woo-hoo!
Is that right? The Rise Up weekend. Going from complacency to what?
Destiny. That's
destiny. Here, come on now. All right, from complacency to destiny. Rise up, rise up. Isaiah chapter 60 and verse 1 says this: Arise, Jerusalem, let your light shine for all the nations to see, for the glory of the Lord is shining on you. Arise, people of God. That's Jerusalem. Say it with me. Arise, people of God. Turn to your neighbor. Say, arise.
Arise.
It's time to rise up.
It's time to rise up.
Let your light shine. Tell them, let your light shine.
Let your light shine.
Why would your light shine? Because his light is shining upon you.
Yes.
I love Fumu. My mom is here visiting. I love having her. My mom and I, we don't get to.
See, we're
my mom's here today. Yeah. But we don't get to see each other too much. She's too busy. But anyhow, what we share is the night sky. We love the night sky. We love stars. We love the night sky. And the moon. You know, we'll talk about those kinds of things.
For a long time, it's amazing. I'm like,
but the whole thing is,
I'm going to bed now. Have fun with that.
but that's, you know, we share the sky. So when I look at the sky, I think of her, and she thinks of me. But you see, the moon is a direct reflection of the sun. You see, your light shines as you recognize that God's light is shining on you. And you can be a great light for everyone. So let your light shine. People of God, arise. Recognize that the favor of God rests upon you.
Yes, it does.
He is shining upon you.
Yes, it is.
Therefore, out of Matthew chapter 5, it says this. It says, you do not light a light and hide it under a bushel. You don't take a light and hide it. Rather, you place it on a lampstand for all to see.
Yes.
You see, that's what I love about my home church here. Okay? Because you are the direct opposite of complacent. You're active. You're a house full of zeal. And the zeal of the Lord is active here, accomplishing his good purposes in the earth through you. Through you, he is accomplishing his purposes in the earth, because he's chosen that. His light shines upon you. You are a light to your community. I love the decree. Everyone, come on. You love that decree. Yeah. This is our community. This is your town. These are your people.
Yeah.
You're the light of the world. You're the salt. You're the ones. Also, we get to go to Kenya. I mean, you are the direct opposite of anything that would represent complacency. Because you're zealous for the Lord. You recognize and see how his light has shone and shines upon you. Are you ready to preach
yet?
No,
you're doing good. Just keep going. Seriously.
Okay. So, in Matthew chapter 25, because I wanted to take a look at complacency, and I was thinking about this, and it's a very harsh word. That was kind of the way I was feeling about it. And that would be one thing I'd never want anyone to describe me as. You know, you're being so complacent. And I was thinking, okay, as a parent, how would I feel or where would I project that possibly on my children? Done it. Right? Been there, done that. And you're trying to what? To bring a motivation to them. And so what you tend to do is say, stop this behavior and start this behavior. Right? You know, stop doing what you're doing, which is virtually nothing, and would you begin to do something? You know, that's kind of the view that we have. But when you have that as the motivation, it's absolutely almost a zero motivation. There's no motivation to it whatsoever. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And it's, you know, the longer and the harder you beat the drum, the more tone deaf they become. And they just don't hear anything about it. Complacency has everything to do with being self-sufficient. Self-sufficient. I'm okay. I'm fine. I don't need anything. I don't need to advance. I don't need to improve. I'm good. All of my efforts, all of my labor, and Scripture speaks about the children of Israel, how they had come out of Egypt, and they entered the land, and some became complacent. We have worked so hard, I've accumulated so much, now I'm just going to sit and rest. And it speaks about that they had not removed the high places, that they had not removed the idols in their heart and life. And that began to bring about destructive cycles in their life. Okay? So what I'm saying here is that then when we become complacent, it results in blind spots in our lives. It results in us not being alert or aware, and we have potential danger in our future. When we become complacent, I begin to rest on me. And I become extremely selfish and consumed with me. And I am unaware of the potential danger that lies ahead. So, when I face complacency, what will I do? What will I do? I did bring something here that I thought I did. Maybe I didn't. I don't know if you can. Yeah. Oh, what's that piece of paper? Oh, that's nothing. Okay. I had something else that I don't have with me, but that's fine.
You got me.
Yeah. And you ready to jump in anytime?
No, you're good.
Okay, so. When you're complacent, here's basically what we do. And I'm going to pull this one
out. You got me, babe. You got me, babe. Babe, babe, babe. Is anyone else no member of the 70s? Okay. I'm going to 52-year-old camp with Bob. Apparently there's this camp for 52-year-olds.
Wow.
Bob is sponsoring it.
Okay. Yeah, that's not complacency at all. She's got a lot of zeal.
Yeah.
When we face complacency, here's basically the things that we tell each other. And it's something that we've learned from our childhood. And it's basically this. Read your Bible and pray every day and you'll grow. So in other words, if you're not growing, you need to read your Bible, pray every day, so that you'll grow. So a lot of times, you know, think, I just need to read my Bible more. I need to pray more. Okay? Another one that will add to that list is I need to go to church. Okay? So I need to increase my church attendance. Okay? Then there's a fourth one that we can add to the list, and that is repentance and resistance of sin. Okay? So you put these four things in your life.
Yeah.
Read your Bible. Pray every day. Okay? The third one was...
Go to church.
Thank you very much.
Stop
go
sinning.
Go to church. And then what?
Stop sinning.
Resist sin and repent. Okay. Now we can go home. Really. You put these four things in your life and you're going to be just fine. Isn't that right? Isn't that kind of the way that we think? Well, let me ask you this question. How's that working for you? You know, really. Because what happens is that we hit the crossroads in our lives of complacency, and it's like, I'm not liking it, people aren't liking it, and we try to beat the drum, and what we present them with is the try hard life. What you need to do is try a little harder. When Audrey and I, we spend a lot of times working with couples, helping couples, in times of just need in their hearts and lives. And, you know, they've had sometimes decades of pain and hurt and dysfunction. And what the last thing that they need is a list of things to do and not to do.
And for us to tell them what's wrong with them,
right?
Because that's been told to them many times.
And so what you need to do is what God has done is that he identifies with us in our pain and in our weakness, and he comes to us where we are. And a lot of times we miss validating the pain and the hurt of people so that we can't help them reconcile with it and to begin to walk out of it. We've come off a very wonderful season within the church, and that is the celebration of Easter. You know, the celebration of the resurrection. But that's a resurrected life that we live forever now. I mean, everything has changed. And I want to experience that in an ever-increasing way in my life. And so I want to recognize that that needs to be a motivation that will draw me into my future rather than just, you know, altering a behavior, you know, that would try to control my future.
So when we're in complacency, we will get to a crossroads where Bob just so clearly had us realize is that all of a sudden, you know what, I get it, things aren't going right, something's not working in my life. What do I do when nothing seems to work? That's basically the question. Because this church, and it's been so evident that we believe in the presence of God. So maybe I'm not feeling or experiencing the presence of God. I'm not feeling that zeal that everyone's talking about. So what do I do when nothing seems to work? Because I need something for a breakthrough of some kind. So that's when the place, if you can imagine with me a pathway, because Lena was talking about that journey, but what happens when your journey gets to a crossroads? Do you know what a crossroads looks like? It looks like a Y. So you come to here, and all of a sudden, you got two pathways in front of you, and you've got to make a choice. If you're wondering why nothing seems to work, that means you're right here. You see that? And you guys get me, right? Okay, thank you. And you've got some choices to make because you've got to choose one way or the other or else you're just paralyzed. You're like, oh. And so the question is, there's a sign. Gotta love signs. And the sign says this way is to please God. This way is to trust God. Which one are you going to choose? It's hard, isn't it? You're sitting there going, well, there's a wrong answer. I don't know. I'm supposed to do both. They both sound really good. Finish it for me.
What's that? No, go ahead.
Go ahead? Okay.
Yeah. No, I got the answer.
That's why he's so good at this.
I've been talking a long time.
So yeah. Okay. I really want you to answer it because you're just really on a roll.
At the crossroads, typically what happens...
Yeah, I told you he'd be profound.
At the crossroads, there tends to be a crisis that has brought you to a place of decision. Okay? And in a crisis, in every crisis, there tends to be complications and confusions because you're experiencing information, and it's usually new information. And that's where the decision then has to be made. But with that information, it's charged with a lot of emotion that really wants to drive your life. And you feel like there's an urgency or almost a panic that I need to make a decision now. And what has brought you to that place of really indecision is a fear or even a sense of failure. I've either done something or I've participated with something.
I'm not good enough. I'm a disappointment.
Yeah, whatever it might be. And I've written down, you know, just a list of fears that really want to emotionally drive your life. And those fears can be inadequacy, a fear of losing control, a fear of rejection, change, a fear of lack, or a fear of even being vulnerable. A fear of missing out, a fear of abandonment, the fear of man, or the fear of failure. And each one of you, as I read through that list, all of a sudden you're like, yeah, I can feel that way. I can feel that way. And the danger with fear is that fear always seeks to control. And because I feel an inadequacy about me, I feel like I haven't been enough, I feel that there's been a complacency in my life and things need to change. Therefore, I need to engage and I need to become more active. And what I need to do is I need to please God because God's disappointed with me. In some ways, I've failed him, and in ways I've failed my family, in ways I've failed my children, in ways I've failed others. And these fears, whether it's inadequacy, losing control, fear of man, those fears want to drive our life that I might bring myself to a place where now are you happy with me? Now am I pleasing to you? Will you now accept me? Will you now affirm me? Am I okay now? Do you like me now? Right? Not can you hear me, but do you like me?
Yeah.
How many checked your Facebook this morning? Do they like you today?
Yeah.
How many likes do you got now? But you see the pressure, because all of a sudden we've hit this junction point. A crisis is always a turning point in the progress of something, the progress of our life. And so fear will always want to control and drive you to a place where I will please another. So, is God pleased with you? Or is he disappointed with you? You see, if you have the lie written on your heart that I'm a disappointment to God, you will remove yourself from his presence. You'll isolate yourself.
You don't deserve it.
You don't deserve it, and as well, who wants to hang out with somebody where they feel like you're a disappointment? You don't want to go there. If I'm a failure to God, I'm not going to go there. But what we then do at this crossroads is, will I begin to trust him? Because trust is active faith in the promises of God. Trust is an absolute hope-filled, okay, in the promise of God that then draws me into my preferred future for my life, mm-hmm. which then pulls me into my destiny. And let me just say with the word destiny, a lot of times we view destiny as a destination, as a place that I need to arrive. You see, that will always lead to complacency. Okay, because destiny has far more to do with design than a destination. You see, you were designed to be worshipers of the Most High God. After the fall, you were redeemed that you might be worshipers of the Most High God. Worship is a huge part of your life. That's part of your destiny. That's part of your design.
And you were also designed to be friends with God. You were designed to know that he's your dad. You were designed to be in very close relationship with Him. You were designed to walk and talk with Him throughout the day, 24/7. You were never designed to live this life alone.
So I'm going to pass it on to you in just a moment.
That's right, you said get that one.
No, it's very good. This is exactly where we're going. So then rather than the try hard life,
which is pleasing God, remember this?
Rather than the pleasing and trying to gain His approval, I'm going to trust in the finished work of Jesus. Because of His death, burial, His resurrection, and listen to this, because of His ascension, because He is now seated at the right hand of the Father, I am an heir. More than an heir, I am a joint heir. Therefore, there is an identical inheritance for me as a son and as a daughter of God. He has an inheritance for me. He has a destiny for me. Woo! There is a design for my life.
Yes, there is, Bob.
Okay, so there is a trust. So if the finished work of Jesus is really real, and if His word is really, really true, then I can trust Him. And in trusting Him, then I begin to be drawn into His preferred future in my life. Therefore, when I read my Bible, and I pray every day, and I hang out with the people of God, okay, and I allow repentance, the changing, the renewing of my mind taking place in my heart and life, I will grow. Because I'm being drawn rather than being determined to make it happen. I'm going to trust in the finished work of Jesus, and I'm going to allow His life, because that's the divine exchange. My life for His life. My ways for His ways. My thoughts for His thoughts.
Yes.
That's the putting off of the old and the putting on in the new.
Yes.
That's what it's about.
Yes.
So that's the invitation today.
Yes.
To rise up. I'm going to arise. People of God, arise. Why? Because His light, His favor shines upon you. Amen. You're not a disappointment to Him.
Right.
You're not a failure to Him. You're precious. He's pursued you. He's bought you. He has everything that you need in Christ Jesus that pertains to life and godliness.
It's yours.
You lack nothing.
Nothing.
Fear does not need to motivate and drive your life any longer. That's good news.
Yes.
That was worth getting up early this morning to get here.
That's right.
Okay. So now what we want to do is put some wheels to the car.
Okay.
Okay? Put some gas in the tank. Because this is everyday life.
That's right.
Everyday life.
Right.
I want to wake up experiencing effortless victory.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, so we got this far, right? We were stuck here, remember? And this was pleasing God, and this was trusting God. Now, do you understand why we're going to... Of course we want to please God, but that's not the road we want to take, because that'll just get us to trying hard. We're going to take this road where we trust that even on my worst day, His presence is so real that He's not waiting for me to get somewhere. He's coming right to me the minute. Do you remember that song? He's as close as the mention of His name. Like, that's when you just have to say, yep, I'm having the worst day, but Jesus. Jesus. And immediately the presence of God is available for you. In a nanosecond, He's there for you. So we're going to go on this one. What is this? What is this? What is this
trust,
path?
Trust.
Just say, I'm going to trust God. I'm choosing the path to trust God. That's some good news for some people today, because some of you have been trying really hard. This is a breath of fresh air. This is where you can breathe again and say, wow, God is really that good and that faithful. He loves me that much. Okay, so now we're going to go down this path. We all made the decision. We're all in unity here, right? We're all here? Okay, good. Everyone in agreement, say aye. 100%. Okay. Now, what happens when you wake up in the morning? and you're just not feeling it. What I like to say,
kind of like saying, you know, hey, did you wake up grumpy? And it's like, no, I left her in bed. You can use that later, Roger.
Okay, now it's going to be where this is where I get super passionate, because I realize that when I wake up, sometimes I have this, I don't know if I ever shared this before, but there is an Audrey sometimes that enters into my life. Do you know the enemy can only do two things, right? He can lie and he can accuse. Only power he has is to lie and accuse. But sometimes I see myself with a t-shirt that says, Judge Audrey. And she's thinking of all the stupid things you've done and your inabilities for the day and all the things that you have to do that day and you can't do it. This is the accuser. So it's like, it's not me, but I'm just saying there's a part of me that uses my thoughts so that when I wake up in the morning, I feel like Judge Audrey is sitting there waiting for me to wake up. Because the second I come to conscious mind, Judge Audrey is saying, you're not going to have enough for today. You're not going to be able to do it. You're this. Is it just me? Or do you wake up sometimes with Judge somebody waking you up? Well, you need to fire that judge. You're fired. Like, honestly. Like, get a visual of that. Because that is not God's heart for you ever. And we do not need to have a judge in our life to tell us what we're not, what was that word? Tell us what we're doing wrong. Because Jesus wants you to wake up. And the second that you come to conscious thought every morning, he wants to tell you what's right with you. Can you imagine how different your day will go if you make this your intention? I got so passionate about this, about how this looks like, those first 5 minutes, that first hour of your day, how you're aligning yourself to heaven to set yourself up to go on your journey as a Holy Spirit person, an agreement with heaven. So I wrote this entire book, and this amazing publisher got it, and it's called Wake Up Smiling. It's like the it's brand new. That's why I had to show you guys, because it's the ultimate Mother's Day present. I brought some for you guys. But basically, this is the concept. When I'm about to drive my... Okay, we're driving down this new pathway of trusting God, but the question is, who's driving your car? Because you see, I have a Holy Spirit, Audrey. If we have the Holy Spirit in us, Christ in me is my hope of glory, that actually means Christ in us. So that actually means that he has somehow stepped into me, and I have stepped into him at the right hand of the Father, and we are in agreement with this, and I am aligned with heaven because I'm a Holy Spirit, Audrey. So I started thinking, I've got to get to know this Holy Spirit, Audrey, because I want this Holy Spirit, Audrey, to take the lead. So I imagine myself, what does Holy Spirit Ben look like? He wakes up and knows his kingly anointing. He knows that the wisdom is available to him. He knows that this is the day the Lord has made him. And Holy Spirit Ben always knows God's thoughts. Holy Spirit Ben always knows exactly which way to turn because he's so in heart with his Father that he knows. See, that's Holy Spirit Ben. Who is Holy Spirit you? Holy Spirit you is in complete agreement with everything that God says about you. And guess what you look like? As a girl, I look beautiful because my innocence is restored. I'm like so white that I'm transparent. There is nothing evil about Holy Spirit Audrey. I am completely 100% renewed. That is Holy Spirit Audrey. And if someone's going to drive the car, I want Holy Spirit to drive the car because that is a really good plan. And I love a good plan. Okay, so imagine yourself as Spirit, whatever your name is. Like Spirit Bob, Spirit Audrey, Holy Spirit, take the lead. So I believe that every morning we should wake up and surrender to Holy Spirit. Surrender to Spirit Audrey, who is surrendered to Holy Spirit, to drive my car. I see it like a car because I'm a visual person. I also have to see it in the car because as soon as something starts going wrong in a day, or is it just me? Or you get a negative thought, or you get a fear, or something like that. Or something bad happens, or a challenge comes up, but you feel that disconnect, and you're not feeling so Holy Spirit. That's when you just have to ask yourself the question, who took the wheel? I'll tell you who took the wheel. There's a few options. Maybe emotion Audrey took the wheel. Maybe your emotions decided to drive your car. Because you're upset, you're angry, you're fearful, you're feeling this, you're feeling that, and you have somebody hurt your feelings or something like that, I'll tell you, emotions came and took the wheel. And it's taking you to places that can last days of pathways you do not want to take. So I surrender emotions to Holy Spirit, Audrey. And the first thing in the morning, I say, okay, emotions, you can have a shotgun because I'm an emotional person. So you don't have to be in the back seat, but emotions. Thank you, God. I used to be mad at my emotions for driving my car, but I realized that God gave us the gift of emotions to experience life. See, God has given you the ability to feel happy and sad and loving and all these things and compassion for others. Emotions are a beautiful gift that God has given us to experience the fullness of life as they are surrendered to who? Holy Spirit. So recognize when emotions take over and start driving the car. The other one that can drive the car is your thoughts, your mind. Can all of a sudden you start thinking things that are not blessing you? You can start thinking things that are not good. Well, first thing in the morning, get that thing lined up to heaven and say, thoughts, I thank God for my strong mind. I thank you for what you've given me. But now I surrender my mind to who? The Holy Spirit. Do you see how simple this is? So thoughts are in the back seat. And then also in the car is my will. Okay, I just happen to have a really strong will, so I imagine it like a little will going, like I wake up with a will. Like I wake up with like a list of things to do, and will is just ready to take the wheel. Like we're going to rock this day, you know what I mean? And so I'm thankful for my strong will because I'm a highly motivated person. So I say thank you, God, for my will, but it's got to stay surrendered to the Holy Spirit. Because the Lord has shown me sometimes that I do 10 times things that he never asked me to do. Because will took over and took the car and went places fast. Now, maybe you don't have a strong will. Maybe your will wants to drive the car and go like this all day. Like none, like zero, like, you know, complacency. Well, you can say, Holy Spirit, you're surrendered to Holy Will, you're surrendered to Holy Spirit. And so you cannot drive the car. Holy Spirit is always ready to do the will of God. And so we are surrendering our will. I hope this is helping you guys. It just gets super practical for me because as soon as I'm feeling a funk in my day, I know I have to just say, God, who took over? Because it wasn't you. So it was either will, emotions, or mind. And then recently, I figured out that there's also ego. Okay, ego is your selfish version of you. Who whenever you get scared or you get shamed or you get something you want to prove yourself, it wants to drive the car. And it's always going to prove, ego always wants to preserve your sense of self, earthly self. Not the Holy Spirit you, but the earthly rights and your earthly this and your earthly measurements. Ego wants to measure you according to everyone else in the world. Ego can get you into so much trouble. Because ego, you know, actually measures your likes according to other people's likes. All that kind of stuff. All the things that can get you without Holy Spirit driving the car. So I actually put ego in the trunk. I want to starve ego to death. Okay, so ego's in the trunk. And that is how we drive our Holy Spirit car on a journey down trusting God. Oh, thank you, guys. You guys get me. So I put all this in this book, and it was like, I just wanted to say that when it's all about, I hope you're hearing this, it's about surrender. Because the point is that living a life in the Spirit is literally God's strength. And living a life with the flesh, with anyone else driving the car, is living in your own strength. And it is your choice every day, every moment of the day, whose strength are you going to live with? Are you going to live in the powerful, limitless, amazing, extraordinary strength of God? Or are you going to live by your own strength? Because God hides the truth from those who think themselves so strong and so wise and clever. And he reveals his secrets to the childlike ones that depend on him and know their dad.
I want to trust. Okay. Trust is an absolute persuasion. I want to persuade my heart of the truth of God. I want to persuade my heart of the promises of God. Okay, I want to have absolute confidence. I want to have trust. Okay, just like the chair that you're sitting on, I didn't see anyone come in today and inspect their chair before they put their full body weight on it. All right?
Yeah.
Why? Because you've experienced week after week, this chair is going to hold me, all right? Now, if you come in next week and your chair breaks on you, you'll come the following week and you'll inspect, right? Okay, but you have absolute confidence because of past history. So what you need to do is you need to nurture and you need to cultivate his presence. You need to practice his presence. That's what I love so much about this church family, because we place a high priority on experiencing his absolutes. Because I want his view and his opinion of me to become my reality. Because when that happens, then I have no problem with following the leading of the Holy Spirit in my life.
Yeah.
You see, as I begin to practice his presence, I've shared Colossians 1:27, Christ in you is your hope of glory. He's in me, and because he's in me, he resides within me. Because he resides within me, I have hope. Hope is that confident expectation. Hope isn't wishful thinking. Rather, hope is being fully persuaded of the absolutes of God. And because of that, he then draws me into glory. And glory is when God's view and opinion of me becomes my reality. So let that be. As you take this journey of trust, might you begin to really persuade your heart? Identify the fears. Identify the fears, because what they cultivate and create in your life are limiting beliefs. And when you have those limiting beliefs, then no longer do you trust. So when you begin to identify a fear, because that fear will want to control, that fear will want to drive your car. So when you begin to identify the fears of your life, and fear, the fear is always saturated in selfishness. And the opposite of selfishness is what? Love. Love. And so complacency comes when I've experienced God and I've experienced his provision, but I've said, that's enough, and I do not allow love to have its completed work in me where I begin to give it away. See, love must be not only received, but true love is love that is received and then also given away. Because selfishness will want to step in there and make it about me, creating a complacent heart. But when you recognize the zeal of God, the shining of his light upon you, that you can then reflect his glory in the earth. You need to be extremely magnetic for God. You need to be extremely what? Contagious. And so when you've experienced his love, then don't allow yourself to become complacent, but begin to give it away. Why would you ever start a work in Kenya? Because you can't help yourself. You can't help yourself. Because you know how good God's been to you. You recognize a need. You can't help yourself, but to meet that need. That's love.
Yeah.
So when you take a look at Matthew 25, it speaks about their talents being given. 5, 3, and 1. Okay? Each of them, okay, believed, you know, they responded to what they believed in their heart, but one was motivated by fear, so he took the talent that was given to him and he buried it. And what he had was then taken away from him. But each of them were given a talent according to their ability. Everyone say ability. I have an ability. Okay? And God's not setting you up to fail. All right? Then it goes on, and this is really neat about the chapter, because it ends with, when did you see me naked, hungry, and imprisoned? You see, Jesus says, as you've done it unto the least of these, you've done it unto me. But Lord, when did we see you? See, that is love. You see, that's the talent that you have and the multiplication of that talent. You know, and because it's not just a financial thing, but it's a love that cannot be contained. And he says, when you take the gifts and the talents I give to you, and you allow my love to have its completed work within you, you will influence the world around you. The decree that we shared together while we took up the offering, those aren't just nice words. Those are proclamations and declarations that we set out in the heavenlies that will have a direct effect in my life. You see, you will be an influencer in your community. You will be that influencer in your school. You will be that influencer in your workplace. This isn't just something that we do here, but it's from here that we read our Bibles, we pray, we encourage one another as the body of Christ. We renew our mind and we go out and we love this world. So from a junction point, from a turning point, from a crisis in your life, with all of these emotions that want to drive your car, with your strong will, you know, with your ego, whatever it might be, I'm going to recognize that my life is hidden in God in Christ Jesus. No longer I that live, but Christ lives in me. And because of that, I can yield myself to His direction, to His leading, and to His guidance. I can trust Him. I know that He has a preferred future for me. He's not out to punish me. I'm not a disappointment to Him. He shines His light upon me. And because of that, He has given me talents. And in those talents, I'm going to use those to serve others. I want love to have its completed work because I want that transplant to happen in my life. A transplant from the soil of fear to being transplanted into the soil of God's marvelous love. See, when you know how fully and completely and loved you really are, that becomes your motivation. That becomes the very thing that draws you into your future. See, what knits our hearts together is not that I want to be a better husband, not that I'm a disappointment. I mean, those are all, you know, things I do. I mess things up all the time. But the whole thing is that she loves me. And I know that she, and because of her motivation of love, it draws me. And that will affect my behavior. I'm going to renew my mind because of this extravagant love. So when you practice His presence, you experience that love. Now, the hardness of your heart, mind. That's when we begin the transplant from soil of fear that will limit your life into the soil of His marvelous love. I think you got a verse or two.
Yeah, but I'm going to start right off that. So the question and the invitation to you today, not the challenge, is when you wake up tomorrow, April 24th, Miracle Monday. Bob and I have always penned Mondays as Miracle Monday. It's kind of a family thing. We have a text going. We're like, what are we going to do today, Miracle Monday? Because Mondays are a great day. Not that every day isn't, but we just kind of really go there on Mondays. So it's April 24th. Guess what? Everyone is going to go to bed tonight. We're going to wake up tomorrow, April 24th. And Spirit U is wanting to drive the car tomorrow morning. Okay? Because you're going to take a road down this place of trust and you're going to love your life. I'm telling you right now, when Spirit is driving the car and you feed your spirit and there are ways to feed your spirit, I'm going to tell you, you are going to love your life. But who are you going to wake up to tomorrow? Because it used to be Judge Audrey that woke me up in the morning. But what is the opposite of that? Mercy. Now I see mercy waking me up for the first thoughts every morning because we can sometimes think of mercy as this nice little emotion, you know, oh, clothe yourselves with tender-hearted mercy. That sounds so nice and sweet and soft, and it is, but mercy is powerful. There's the word triumph. When you think of triumph, what do you think of? I mean, that's the extreme victory over the biggest enemies. That is a triumph. Well, the Bible says that mercy triumphs over judgment. So instead of just firing that judge, you can say mercy has annihilated the judge, and mercy wants to wake you up tomorrow morning. The first thoughts you have when you wake up tomorrow morning, I want you to have immediately train your thoughts not to drive, because your thoughts will wake up and your emotions will wake up and want to drive the car immediately. If you're a person, that happens. But because your spirit, Audrey, because your spirit you, because your spirit, Ben, you can wake up and immediately go, oh yeah, mercy is waking me up this morning. mercy is making me up this morning. It triumphs over judgment, which means if judgment has been annihilated, then I'm not going to be able to judge anybody today, and I'm not even going to judge myself today. The Holy Spirit, Audrey, is driving this car, and we are going places in the Spirit, fulfilling destiny, and it's not as hard as we think, people. It's pretty simple. If we can kind of get just aligned with heaven, even during storms of life and seasons of life, we get to live in this place called peace and mercy and joy, because the kingdom of God is all about righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. So I encourage you, tomorrow is going to be a really good Miracle Monday. I mean, today's going to be a great rest of the day. But tomorrow you're going to be freaked out when you start living this way. Because it's going to be Miracle Monday. Mercy's going to wake you up. I double dog dare you to go there. Picture yourself as what you look like in the Spirit. Start getting to know Spirit you. If you can, buy this book, because it's a 40-day devotional teaching you how to feed your spirit and drive that car in a way that doesn't feel driven at all. It feels awesome. Okay.
Good. Awesome. All right. The invitation is really simply to participate. So let's take a moment in closing. Let's just close our eyes, and I want to read Philippians chapter 3, verses 9 to 14. And I want you to begin to hear these words, begin to let them be a seed that is planted deep within your heart. Because when it counts, I want to be found belonging to Him. Not clinging to my own righteousness based on law, but actively relying on the faithfulness of the Anointed One. This is true righteousness supplied by God, acquired by faith. I want to know Him inside and out. Yes. I want to experience the power of His resurrection and join in His suffering, shaped by His death, so that I may arrive safely at the resurrection from the dead. I'm not there yet, nor have I become perfect, but I am charging on to gain everything and anything that the Anointed One Jesus has in store for me. And nothing will stand in my way, because He has grabbed me and He won't let me go. Let Him hold you. Brothers and sisters, I said, I know and I have not arrived, but there's one thing I am doing. I'm leaving the old life behind, putting everything on the line for this mission. I'm sprinting towards the only goal that counts, the cross, in order that I might cross the line to win the prize, to hear my Father's voice, called to the resurrection life found exclusively in Jesus, the Anointed One. Father, thank You for this morning. For each heart and life that's represented here, we stand at that crossroads. And I thank You that I can hide. Not only high, but I can experience the resurrected life because of You, Jesus. Therefore, I choose to trust You. And in trusting You, I bring pleasure to You. I thank You for that. So, Lord, as I look over the landscape of my life, I recognize there's a lot of things that are yet before me. But I understand that You have a preferred future for my life. And I don't need to be afraid. I don't need to be apprehensive. I don't need to feel as though I'm in a place of lack. I recognize and I see that there are fears that want to control. But this day, I invite You, Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, lead me, guide me, speak to me. Lead me in such a way, because I will follow. Jesus, as You came to Your disciples and You invited them to come and follow You, this day, everyone say with me, this day, I say, Jesus,
You
are Lord of my life.
You are Lord of my life.
And I will follow you. Father.
Father.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For the gift of the Holy Spirit.
For the gift of the Holy Spirit.
That empowers my life. From this day forward.
From this day forth.
Everything is different.
Everything is different.
Because of you.
Amen. We love you guys. Thank you so much. I'm so excited for your day tomorrow. You have no idea.